Enter Talk Radio. You're in to all things music.
Welcome to the Changing Stage, music gear talk from the manufacturers and musicians who define the biz. Here's your host, Florentino Buenaventura.
This is the Changing Stage Radio Show, powered by the mighty Inner Talk Media Networks, and I am Florentino Buenaventura, the host of the Changing Stage, and what you just heard was ELO, Jeff Lynne's ELO, live at Wembley Stadium, and that deep pocket that you just heard was Donovan Hepburn, and he is live with us. Donovan, say hello, sir.
Hello, everyone. How are you?
Everyone is definitely enthusiastic around here at the station, and we're really, really honored to have you on board. Before we get started, I have to give a shout out to our sponsors, Jambox, where they allow anybody musically inclined to play, whether they are beginners to the professional. Jambox is that instrument that it's just this wonderful piece of gear. At some point, we're going to have to tell you a little bit more about that one. Maybe we'll talk about that later on in the show, Donovan. Pitbull Audio at pitbullaudio.com. Okay. Those guys over there are powering the music industry with great gear. They're the retailer that is just fastest growing retailer in the country. And I want to give a shout out to all the fun folks over at Yamaha, because this is a Yamaha Spotlight episode, because you are a Yamaha artist. So,
I am indeed.
Yes, you are, sir. And I got all that stuff out. That was a mouthful. Let's just jump right into it, Donovan. You are out right now on tour with ELO, and you guys are killing it.
I am doing
stadiums.
Tell us about
where you're going to be heading to next. You're headed back to your hotel right now, but you got a show here. Tell us a bit about what's going on.
So we're in Houston today, and it's the first time as a band we've come here. Jeff Lynne's version of ELO has come here. So I thought, being the sort of tourist I am, I thought we can't go to Houston without going and having a day at NASA. So that's where we are. We've just left. So I'm heading back to the hotel to get there in time for sound check. But we played Denver two nights ago, which was absolutely amazing. And we're here tonight, and then we leave for Dallas in the morning. It's been an amazing journey so far. The crowds out here are absolutely out of this world. It's been amazing. We started in Oakland last week, and then we've done two nights at the Forum in Los Angeles. Yeah, and then, like I say, Denver, and then tonight is show number 5. Of the American leg of the tour, and it's been received so well. All the fans we've met, some in the hotel, and just being out and about on the street, the energy and the reception that we've got has just been absolutely mind-blowing. We're loving every minute of it. We have so much fun sharing this awesome music with everybody, and just helping people just create these amazing moments. And there's so much history and nostalgia linked to this music, and just seeing the fans' faces and how they're responding to each song, it's actually a joy for us to be able to deliver it to everyone, really. So yeah, we're having an absolute blast. So,
well,
yeah, man.
That is awesome to hear. So make sure, folks, you go to ELO's website to see the tour guide, because it's a huge one. And, you know, I have to ask you personally, what do you think is ELO's staying power? Because very frankly, a lot of bands that came out during that time that ELO just came out, they're not quite doing the same things that ELO still is doing, as in way of stadiums and new projects. Yeah. Jeff Lynne is killing it. So what's your perspective of why they're so relevant today as they were for all these years?
I think for me, so I'm one of the younger members in the band. Now, I don't have a lot of knowledge on the band the first time around. So I came to it quite late. I've always heard Mr. Blue Sky. I've always heard Living Thing. I've always heard 10538. I've heard these tunes throughout my childhood. But in terms of, you know, I became a fan, you know, when I got the gig. And for me, I'll be honest with you, what excited me was just the depth of the songs. You know, these are like classic rock and pop songs, some progressive rock. And it was that very thing on its own, which really kind of captivated me as a young person. So then when you couple that with, you know, guys who are older than me and who remember the band from the 70s and stuff, you talk to them and they're saying the same thing back to you, but from their perspective when they were my age and younger. It's like the sort of common denominator throughout the generations, it's just great feel-good songs, and you sort of connect with the temperament or the mood or the energy or the vibe that Jeff was feeling at the time he penned these songs. And you know, we just played "Don't Bring Me Down." You hear a song like that, or a song like "Telephone Line," and it's still as relevant today, musically, lyrically, melodically, as it was all the way back when it was recorded. And it's just like you can't deny a great song, you know. And I think, you know, that from my personal perspective, that's what people have tapped into. And when you hear Jeff sing, I mean, he's singing so incredibly well at the moment, and people are connecting with the true sentiment of how he penned those songs, you know. And even to do, you know, a new record, you know, with a song like "When I Was a Boy" after "The Alone in the Universe," you listen to the lyrics of it, and it's just, you know, it's every kid's dream. You know, you think of, you know, every kid who wants to grow up and be a rock star or wants to be a sport. You know, we all had some sort of dream that we wanted to aspire to. So you hear a song like that, and there's an instant connect. You know, all these years later, he's penned a new record, and it's had the same, if not more, effect. So That's my personal perspective on it. And the more I speak to people, everyone's saying the same thing. It's just great, feel-good music. And my favorite thing is all the memories that people have that are attached to the music. So we've met fans who say, "Oh, man, I remember this when I was in high school. And, you know, I remember that, you know, because this song helped me get through a bad breakup. And I remember this song when, you know, I graduated from high school." You know, and there's all these songs that hold so many fond memories for so many different people. So it's just, honestly, it's just an awesome thing to be a part of. It really is, man. Yeah. You know, and then, you know, we do these shows, and especially this time, the audiences are varying in terms of ages. So we're seeing sort of people in their 20s right up to people in their 60s and 70s. And it's just, it's testament to the music, you know? And the great man himself who penned all this amazing stuff, you know.
No, I totally get that, and I think you kind of touched on a couple of different things, that the music is pop, you know, has a pop feel, but it has the artistic integrity of progressive and other forms of, you know, technically challenging art form. So I think that is a great, great big you know, reason for all of this. And you know, I think that it was coined by a Modern Drummer magazine that you follow pretty much the standard drum parts, but you bring a pocket that is just indomitable. And that came from what I would imagine from your beginnings in the church, gospel chops, man.
Yes.
How does that form of playing apply to, like, you know, a pop-centric, progressive rock slash, you know, straightforward rock type of project like this? You know, talk about how the playing and you know, how you kind of melded everything together.
Yeah, so obviously, you know, growing up in a Christian home, obviously church was a massive, and is a massive part of my life today. And playing in church, you know, there's no sort of music that you read. It's very much based on your feeling, on your emotion. And I think, just like I said before, that's the immediate connect for me with this style of music and this particular artist, is that I feel like there's a meeting of minds in terms of his approach to music and how he, you know, wrote these particular songs. So for me, you know, getting on a gig like this, and I think I quoted in my interview, you know, if I was to play Telephone Line in any other way, to me, it wouldn't be Telephone Line, let alone the fact that I'm working, you know, not only working with a singer, but I'm working with a producer and the guy who's played this stuff and wrote it for how it should be played. You know, the minute I change that, the minute I, you know, change that and don't do the fills that lead into the chorus of Telephone Line, I believe I actually take away from the song, you know. And I remember one of the very first times we rehearsed with Jeff for the Hyde Park show, in fact. And he came in, I think we were actually playing Telephone Line, and he came in and he stood in the control booth. And, you know, he came around and, you know, we sort of all met him. One of the things he said to me, he says, "Bud, your snare sounds great, and the rest of your kit, I've had your toms turn up because those parts are important." And I remember him saying that, and I was like, that what that said to me is that, okay, he's written these parts, and those particular fills are part of the orchestration as well. So it just, without him even having to say, he was basically saying, I have to stay true to the parts. And, you know, the more we've learned more of the catalogue, you know, the same can be said for many of his tunes. I remember playing Sweet Talking Woman, and again, he said to me, like, because my natural instinct as a player is to, you know, create dynamics, create highs and create lows, and which is totally the right approach. But I remember him just saying, you know, you hear the little strings intro for Sweet Talking Woman, and he used the phrase, he just said, "And then you just come crashing in," which basically said to me, how I'm hearing it on the record is how he wants it to be heard. So, you know, there wasn't a particular dynamic that was used. It was just like, because there was an emotion that he was trying to get when the drums came in. So the more I've worked with him, it's just allowing, I've just become more astute to how he wants things replayed, and just trying to understand where he was coming from at the time he wrote these particular songs. And, you know, it's an absolute pleasure for me to be able to try and recreate it, you know, and give it the due diligence, you know, that I believe it deserves, you know?
Yeah, I agree wholeheartedly there. You know, kind of with that said, man, when we first got the gig, you know, were they doing auditions? Did they say you're the guy because we've heard you on other projects? How did that come about?
So the gig came about. So as a unit, the band, we all work for many various artists as a unit, and our musical director Mike Stevens, he got the call to put together a band for a show that we have in the UK called Children in Need. It's like a charity called Children in Need. And we were the house band for that particular show. And one of the artists who was going to be featured was Jeff Lynne.
Okay.
So we did that show. We played Mr. Blue Sky and Living Thing. And then, you know, it was a great joy to do just those two tunes. Obviously, you know, working with such a great iconic artist. The following year, there was a BBC Party in the Park concert, and that was hosted by a radio DJ called Chris Evans from BBC Radio 2. And they requested Jeff Lynne to be the headline act. And he so graciously said, you know, one of the conditions of me doing it is if I can do it with Mike Stevens and his band, mm-hmm. who worked with him the year before. So that's basically it. And, you know, as they say, the rest is history. You know, we did that Hyde Park show, and then it just sort of snowballed from there, really. We after Hyde Park, we did the Grammys. We came out here to do the Grammys. And then, you know the rest. He recorded another record, and then we went on tour. And, you know, we're in our fourth year now of working with him as you know, the Electric Light Orchestra, Jeff Lynne, ELO. So it's just been an amazing journey. And then, you know, after the success of the UK tour, you know, we've got obviously the American leg now, and then we go in and do Europe. And it's just been like an amazing roller coaster ride, or should I say a spaceship ride. It's been amazing, absolutely amazing. So yeah, that's basically the long and short of, you know, my particular journey with ELO.
Yeah, and then, you know, that's been pretty amazing. But that wasn't the first go around for you. You've done some pretty amazing things before the ELO project. You know, obviously, you being in Britain, you've kind of gotten access to incredible talents. I know Adele was one of the projects that you worked on, and
yeah.
You know, Shirley Bassey, who I'm a big fan of. I'm a big fan of both, mm-hmm. but you know, Shirley Bassey is you know, iconic. Both of them are iconic, but pretty awesome. Tell us about some of the experiences that you've had pre ELO.
So pre-ELO, you know, like I said, my CV includes like the likes of Shirley Bassey and Adele. And we also worked for a UK band called Take That, which is like sort of England's answer to New Kids on the Block. It was that sort of era, really.
I remember
so,
them.
You know, we've done several tours with them. And again, it's pretty much the same unit of musicians who have worked together on multiple stuff. So yeah, it's just been fun. You know, we had the opportunity to play for the Queen Simon Jubilee, which involved multiple artists. So yeah, it's been a bit of an amazing time, really. Definitely.
Wow. And you recorded with Adele on her 19 album, right? No, when you guys did that.
No, it was just a live show that was recorded.
Oh, okay.
At the Highline Ballroom. Yeah. Yeah, not the actual records.
Oh, okay.
It was a 19 campaign, it was.
Okay.
And we played Los Angeles, Toronto, and New York.
Now, was that when that...
But then we did a few shows around the UK, too.
And when you were... obviously, that was kind of her big breakout album. When you were doing these shows, did you realize how big she was going to be when that all kind of come about, or had she already?
I know it's a cliche thing, but there was always something that was a little bit different about her than the rest. I didn't know how big it would go, but yeah, you could sort of see that she was sort of cut a little bit different from the rest. So yeah, I mean, it's no surprise at all to see how well she's done. And, you know, she's still really cool and down to earth as well. So
yeah, amazing. Yeah. And she was so young at the time. That was crazy.
Yeah.
You know, just, you know, because she had such a matured voice, and the project was deep, man. It was deep.
Yeah, it really was. Yeah. And again, a lot of people connected to what it was she was trying to say at that particular time, you know?
So, yeah.
Yeah.
So let's kind of go back a little bit to your start and your roots in church, and I'm definitely, that's where, you know, I got my musical starts. I'm a bass player, so we're natural kin, man. You're me and drummer, and I'm a bass player.
We're good fit. Yeah, that's it.
Definitely. did you start off on Yamaha? I'm going to put you on the spot here, man, because I know Michael and all the rest of the team over at Yamaha are probably listening.
Everybody's listening. See, that's a trick question. That's a loaded question, right?
It is, it is. We know who you're playing now, though. I'll say that.
Yeah, yeah. No, I actually started on Pearl. My brother, back in 1985, brought a Pearl kit, and I remember him coming home and, you know, setting up his kit. And I remember going into my living room at the time and just seeing this Pearl kit, and it was in white. And I think that's where the initial seed was sown for me. So yeah, and he had that kit set up in the house, and then it was in church, and I remember that's the kit I first started playing.
Oh, okay.
And then, you know, as I grew up, I also played Palmer drums.
Okay.
First, that was my first deal, and then I played Premier.
Okay.
And then I've been a Yamaha player since 2010, actually.
Okay. So a little bit of time.
9 years, yeah.
So
yeah.
What was it?
I've always been a fan of this one.
What was it like when you got your first Yamaha kit? Was that one that you bought, or did the endorsement start off right away? Or tell us about that experience and that feeling when you opened it up.
It was one that they sent over. I was working with a UK artist, and they sent one to the studio for me to use. But because I played them, you know, different points in my career, growing up, so I sort of knew, I was familiar with the range, and they sent this Maple Custom down for me to use, and I immediately put Clear Ambassadors on, Power Stroke, it was a Power Stroke 3 at the time on the kick drum, and it was up, set up and ready. It was absolutely brilliant, and it sounded like all the rest of the Maple Customs that were out there. The thing that attracted me most to Yamaha was their consistency right across the range.
Yeah.
So whether if you're playing rock and you want to play like the rock custom, they've got that. If you want to play a Maple Custom, if you want to play a Maple Custom Absolute, if you want to play a 9000, if you want to play a recording custom, they're consistent across the range. You know, they're very true sounding drums.
Yeah, yeah.
Whatever sort of sound you want to get, and that's my favorite thing about the company is their attention to detail and their consistency right across all the ranges.
And from both studio and live as well. In fact, they're probably the number one drum for studio that I've run across. When you go to studios, it's always a Yamaha kit that they always have as a house kit.
That's it. Yeah, yeah, definitely. So yeah, on this particular job, I'm using a 9000, and it's actually getting better as the time goes on. You know,
that's amazing.
I change the heads, you know, not too often, and they sound absolutely amazing. And yeah, you know, it's probably at time just to chat out Greg and Gavin Thomas back in the UK and all the guys over at Yamaha that take care of me, because I can honestly say that I've been very well looked after. You know, they take care of me greatly, and you know, when I've been in a little bit of a spot, they send stuff out to me wherever I am. And, yeah, they're a great company to be a part of, without a doubt.
They totally support the artists as well. One of the things that we've been working with them is to really give some positive spotlights on the incredible talents that use the Yamaha gear, because they're you know, in this day and age, in this business promotion, whether you are a player or whether you're the actual artist is paramount, and companies getting behind you to make sure that you're getting that support is also paramount. And I think that's a testament to Yamaha. They said, you know, when they approached us and they said, hey, you know, Donovan Hepburn is going to be available, we'd love for you to do an interview with him on your network. And I said, yes, yes, yes. And, you know, because it's just a win all the way around for everybody. You're killing it. Your reputation is stellar. You know, some of the other people that you've played with, whether they be Jesse J, Miss Dynamite, another big favorite of mine, Annie Lennox, you know, just the list goes on. And, you know, Who? Let's kind of go through that list. We're gonna do the name dropping game. Everyone always says don't name drop, okay. But hey, who have you played live with, and who have you recorded with? So, and then did you use different kits in those circumstances, or did you find that your kit that you carry through the stage is also the one that translates on the digital with recording?
I think it's a mixture of both, really. Again, as I said earlier, depending on the style, really, is sort of how I make my decision. So, obviously, on the Wembley and Bus album, it was the kit, obviously, that I was using live, so that's where the crossover was.
Okay.
What you're hearing is exactly how it sounds. Another scenarios I've used the Maple Custom Absolute in the studio, and equally it's been fine. So I thought I try and tailor each situation based on what's required of me as the drummer in the band, as opposed to just having one particular thread. That's what I stick to. I try and vary it. So it's definitely between the Maple Custom and the 9000, which is my main two boxes for recording, and the whole custom. In fact, I've recorded a couple of things with tape that on the old custom.
Awesome.
Which has been discontinued, and that's great. So it gives you a different tone, but equally great. For the music at the time of the recording.
Oh, perfect, perfect. And that's a good timing, too, because we're going to be going in here to a commercial break. Give a little shout out to our sponsors. And kind of with that said, this again is a Yamaha spotlight with Yamaha artist Donovan Hepburn. And he's a gentleman out of the UK, as you can kind of tell. And he's been hugely impactful on the music scene, from working with Adele to Shirley Bassey to Mika Paris, and of course you're out on tour with Jeff Lynne and his group ELO, and it's a pretty amazing stuff. Again, shout out to Jambox, Pitbull Audio, and SIR. I don't know if you're using any SIR on the tour, but SIR is a sponsor of ours as well, and we're really really happy with all of those folks. We'll be right back. Stay tuned. We've got another half hour with Donovan, and we've got more to come. We're going to talk a little bit about his programming and his own passions and his own music. So stay tuned.
Serious about your music? Are you ready to run with the big dogs? The experts at Pitbull Audio have the gear to get you into the game. From leading manufacturers like Mesa Boogie, Fender, Pioneer, and American Audio, to sound your best, you need the best. Pitbull Audio can deliver in rehearsal, on stage, and into the big time. Dropping beats, shredding guitar, or making the crowd roar. Whatever you dream, Pitbull Audio can help make it happen. We are Pitbull Audio. We want you to play it loud. PitbullAudio.com.
This is Jackie Bertone from Jackie's Groove. Come join me weekly on my journey through the music business as I take you behind the velvet rope, interviewing industry notables such as Al Di Meola, Michael McDonald, and Al Jarreau, to name but a few. Listen to their stories on being in the studios recording number one hits and onto the stages throughout the globe. Allow me to be your music historian. You can hear me live every Monday at 2 p.m. and every Wednesday at 12 noon Pacific Standard Time, or 24/7 on jackiesgroove.com. Ready to get your groove on?
You know what's all around you every waking moment of your life? Marketing. You're choking on it. I'm Scott Robertson, and when it comes to strategic PR, branding, and marketing, I've seen it all. And actually, I'm still seeing it, because bad marketing never sleeps. Join me each week on May the Best Brand Win, right here on Inner Talk Radio, and learn how to make the marketing for your brand unforgettable.
Welcome
to the Changing Stage, music gear talk from the manufacturers and musicians who define the biz. Here's your host, Florentino Buenaventura.
We are into the second segment of the Changing Stage radio show. My name is Florentino Buenaventura, and I am your host. And we are on Entertalk Media Networks, and it's going great today. We've got Donovan Hepburn, who's out right now with ELO, the drummer, the guy who sits on that drum throne, laying that deep pocket groove for the ELO band. You know, we've been having a good time. I've been putting on the spot a little bit. You know, we're gonna put you on the spot again right now, man. I'm gonna throw you out there. You played on so many different projects, and hopefully Jeff's not going to hear this, but what's your favorite project? Or maybe it is Jeff's project, you know? What's been your favorite project so far?
You know, I'll be absolutely honest. It's so hard. It's like asking what your favorite movie is. I've got a top five or a top 10 or whatever. There's so many different, but, I mean, Jeff is obviously way up there. Not at the top in terms of, you know, his legacy and, you know, the sort of, you know, you think of how many people he's influenced with his music. So that's definitely up there. Names you've called, really. Shirley Bassey was, you know, you think of, you know, playing a song like Diamonds Are Forever and how iconic that record was.
Yeah.
So to be able to play that in a live capacity. Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, without sounding cliche, it's so hard to pin it down to one particular thing. You know, I've had, you know, some great privilege to play with, you know, so many incredible artists, and, you know, and again, different styles, you know, as opposed to just one thing. But, you know, the Diamond Jubilee concert and playing with all those varied artists, that was, you know, that was amazing. Working with Tom Jones, that was amazing.
Oh, that's not even on your list, man. Where did the Tom Jones come from? That's one of my favorites.
Well, there you go. Just thought I'd throw that in there. But yeah, we did a TV show, and he was on it. And I remember being in the rehearsal room and hearing his voice come down my in-ear monitors and going, oh my Lord, that's him. And I can hear, he was amazing, you know? So yeah, there's so many, you know, it is hard to put it into one, so I'm not gonna, so you can't put me on the spot.
Good political answer. I might have to have you run for the president of the United States, man. You came out of that beautifully. So, yeah, we try to keep you on your toes on this show, man. We like to see that happen. So, you know, you've also been a musical director, and that's usually not the case for drummers. You know, tell us about that experience a little bit. Sam Smith, Jesse J, Miss Dynamite, Adele,
yeah.
Travie McCoy, these were some of the people that you've been musical director for. How does, you know, in that particular spot, it's hard to call that. How do you balance focusing 100% on the groove, but also making sure that all your bandmates are doing what they're supposed to be doing?
So some of the artists you mentioned, I was the MD from this side of the drums. And I think where it all started, because obviously being a drummer in the band, I'm constantly listening to melodic instruments around me. So that's definitely how it all started to develop. Just, you know, unbeknown to me, my ears were constantly picking up on where the bass sits, where the keyboard player sits, where the guitar sits in a group. So that's how, you know, how I sort of got started. But yeah, it's definitely a different headspace, and one I enjoyed. It's a different responsibility. You know, it's about gaining the trust of the artist you're working for, and, you know, getting them around for them to believe that you're going to have their best interests at heart and present them and their show in the best possible light. So I worked with Sam Smith for maybe like 2.5 years. He was on the first campaign that he did. And, you know, again, another incredible artist with an amazing voice and a really great band. I went in and the band was already set. And, you know, it was very much just kind of nurturing the immense talent that was already there. And then I added a few other players. I added some backing vocalists, a string quartet. They just had a cello player, but I, you know, just introduced a quartet for that particular tour. And, you know, it's just helping them transition from, you know, like a small band to bands that can play in major arenas and stadiums. And, you know, just to see them now and how well Sammy's doing and how well the band is, and knowing that you that I had a part in that, it's one of the greatest rewards that I can get, you know, just to see how well they're doing. And, you know, and yeah, Travi was an interesting job. He came over and he had some radio promo, and we did a couple of stuff for the BBC. And again, in a different genre, he sort of knew what he wanted and, you know, the type of band that he wanted. So that's where I came on. But I actually played on that one. And that was equally as great and rewarding. But yeah, it's you know, it's a total different headspace. But like I say, it's one that I enjoy.
Yeah.
Just as much just being the drummer in the band as well. So,
well, you know, that is challenging enough to be the drummer and, you know, and having to kind of keep that meter, and then being that MD, keeping the musicians on track and focus. Let's kind of go. There's going to be it's a 2-part question here for this. What is the most rewarding thing that you've, you know, like instance or experience that you had as a drummer MD, and what was one of the biggest challenges, especially with the personalities and the egos and you know, all the things that kind of come along with musicians and the head trips and everything. Again, I'm a musician, man. I know how it goes, brother. Give us a couple of those experiences.
One of the biggest rewards, I would say, was putting a show for Sam Smith into Madison Square Garden in New York. And just the process from, you know, sitting with him and deciding what songs he wants to do, and, you know, how we arrange the show, you know, building a show intro. And we had a couple of guest spots that came in, and just integrating them into our show. And, you know, that whole process, rehearsing it up for several weeks in the UK. And then, you know, we took the show out on tour. And then, you know, the sort of big show for that tour was Madison Square Garden. Just sitting there after the last note was played and just going, okay, great. That went absolutely brilliant. And the sort of exhale that you feel after that, it was actually out of this world. All those people there. And it was like, wow, I remember creating this show. Yeah, so all those months back, and, like, you know, writing out my notes and, you know, to seeing it there, that was an absolute, you know, pleasure, you know, that was a memory that I won't ever forget.
I can only imagine, because that, well, I didn't mean to interrupt you, but I just was thinking, you know, you're sitting there, you got Sam Smith, he's just huge. You're at Madison Square Garden, where is the, you know, the focal point of, you know, I would imagine for people in the UK going, this is kind of the pinnacle. And throughout that whole show, you're waiting, is there going to be a flub up? Is there going to be an electronical, you know, mess up?
Yeah.
And this is all on my shoulders because I'm in the MD. I can only imagine that relief, that experience could, you know, it's just, it would be amazing.
And don't get me wrong, there was a few, you know, little technical hitches and stuff that I'm not going to mention, but it was like, okay, we got, so don't even ask. But yeah, we, you know, just to get to the end of it, and, you know, the crowd absolutely go crazy for it, and the reviews to be great. It was, you know, a big, big, massive experience for me. So yeah, oh, challenging ones. Oh gosh. That's,
yeah. When did you want to take off one of the cymbals and throw it at somebody? That's the question. just like do the whole James Bond odd chop, whatever. You're not throwing that. Like, get your parts right, man.
Oh my God. I think I'll answer that when we come off air. I don't know. That's a hard one. I can't even think.
We like to, again, we like to put you on the spot. Definitely. I see you have a big career in politics, man. You know, just think about that. You got the good political answers.
I know. Good Lord. I think I might run for governor.
There you go, man.
I can't even think. Yeah, I'm going to pass.
All right, no worries, man.
I'll email you my answer.
No worries, man. We weren't putting anybody on blast. We know that it happens, man. We know that the crazy things go out on tour here. Now, you've got an interesting part of your bio that is here. You are a programmer. You do drum programming, or do you like do full on synth, you know, EDM type of productions?
Yeah, it's a bit of both, really, because obviously in today's popular music, there's you know, certain tracks are made with so many different, you know, instrumentations and stuff, and sometimes it's just not feasible from a budget standpoint to take out, you know, big bands. So they use various bits of programming and stems and things like that. So it's just, again, it was something that I got involved in when I was really young, coming to the industry and, you know, using various music software. And again, it's, like I said, it's just something that's become a big part of today's live music scene, really. So I made it, you know, one of my priorities to get to grips with it and understand how it works. And, you know, there's been certain jobs where I've just been hired just solely to do that role. So yeah, it's just, again, it's part of the thing, really, and something that I advise all up and coming players, drummers as well, to get involved in, or get to grips with, or have some sort of knowledge of it, really.
Electronics and drums. I think that you're correct 100% in that, because a lot of the drummers I know, they try to stay away from that, because that idea, they have the old Simmons sets in mind where they're basically, you're hitting pieces of wood and people were getting carpal tunnel, and you know, that's kind of been their thought process of dealing with electronics and drums. And one of our show hosts, from previous show host, he is a percussionist. And he was very much about the organic, and then he tried out the jam box, which is it's kind of like a harmonica, where he's, you know, you basically use wind to either blow or sip to control the dynamics of the instruments. And predominantly it'd been, saxes and other things, but he used it for percussion, and he's actually been using it to do full albums with it. So, I think electronic, and he was one of those guys that was like, I don't do electronics. When he tried that out, it really made the difference for him. And he's done a couple of jazz albums and, an island reggae album with Henry Capono and stuff like that. So it's been really, really helpful for him. And so I can imagine with you using electronics, especially with Yamaha, do you use a lot of their electronic drum kits and other fun pieces?
I do quite a bit. So the DTX range is you know, an integral part of my style. So they have, you know, they have a varied amounts and drum pads and triggers and, you know, a whole load of that kind of stuff. But it, again, like I said earlier, it depends on the sort of job I'm doing at the time as to how much or how little electronics is needed. But it's definitely, you know, I do get that, and some people frown upon it, and it's not a live snare drum, and it's not a, and I sort of do see where they're coming from, but you can integrate it in other ways as well. I've never gone out there and done a gig solely on an electronic drum kit. I've never done that.
Yeah.
I, I sort of integrate it into my acoustic bit, you know, whether it be to trigger a clap sample or an explosion sample or whatever it could be, you know, depending on whatever gig I'm doing, you know?
Yeah, so it's part of your arsenal, for sure.
Do I think it's something that should be frowned upon? No, is the answer to that. And it's about, you know, from a session musician's perspective, you're hired, you know, to service the music that you've been called to do. So, you know, if a particular track involves, you know, a sort of 808 type of kick, you know, there's ways of doing that,
yeah,
you know, with bits of electronics. So, you know, it's, but I also understand people who just want to be, you know, that kind of organic through and through, and this is what I do and this is who I am. And, you know, choices, but, you know, throughout my career, I've worked with so many different varied things, and you know, there's times where, you know, I have had jobs where I'm playing more electronics than acoustic. You know, like I said, I've never done a complete electronic kit, but, you know, I've had to integrate it more on certain gigs than other.
You do, especially recording, you know, that's part of that. I know that with Daft Punk and, you know, working with Omar Hakim and J.R. Robinson, who has a show with us, you know, they played it all live, but there was a lot of drum replacement sounds because, you know, that electronic sound in pop music is whether you like it or not, it's a must. You can't do the typical pop record without having some electronic drum sounds on it. Just that whole, and people are used to that. Go. Definitely. What I want to hear is I want to hear a little 808 on the ELO project, man. That'd be awesome.
No, you're not
going to
hear any of that. It's healthy, organic, you know, Yamaha 9000.
Yeah.
There's no triggers inside. Everything you're hearing is what's being played. So, yeah, there's no worries of that.
If one of those kicks flew, that would be fun to see the Jeff's face. So that would be great.
I know, right?
Yeah, boom.
I'll do the next gig on a totally electronic kit and see how that goes.
Yeah, definitely looking for a new gig, but kind of going back to the gear thing, man. I was at the Summer NAMM this year, and we got a chance to bring out one of our show hosts, also iconic drummer Aaron A Train Smith, played drums on "Papa Was a Rolling Stone." He played that track, and he's a big Yamaha guy. He uses Yamaha, and he was like floored by that EAD-10. I was too. That new module trigger. Have you played around with that EAD-10 yet?
I haven't yet. I know Gavin has got one ready for me for when I get back to the UK, but I haven't played on one as yet.
Well, it's amazing that it's just one. It's just stellar. At least in that environment where they put one mic that picks everything up, and from what I can gather, it interacts with the actual, you know, the drum triggers, but the fact that it's one mic picks up everything, I just, you know, just the setup idea, just put that on your kick drum and boom. So I don't know. I was amazed. I thought maybe you might have you're going to have to get those guys to get you one ASAP. I was going to say, EADP, but ASAP. I'll get that right.
If Greg's listening, he knows where I'm going to be, so he can get one sent. He can get one sent to Dallas for me.
there you go. So you guys are listening, Michael and the rest of the crew over there, get this man one of these EADs, and that way he can tell us a bit about it. Great. It's a great tool to me. I thought it was great. Coming off of the technology piece here, tell us about your music. We've got about 8 minutes left in this whole interview. It's going way too fast, but tell us about your own music and about what inspires you musically, the stuff that you produce that is all about you.
I mean, again, without sounding too cliche, I'm sort of just inspired by music in general, and I think, you know, obviously being the youngest in my family, coming from a big family as well, there was always something different playing in the house, whether it was, you know, fusion or jazz or R&B or soul music or what. There was always, I just remember there being, when I think of my childhood as in my family home, there was so many different music that just I was, you know, subconsciously just taking in. So when I think of, you know, my own sort of music or my own kind of personal taste, it's so varied, you know. You know, when I think of, you know, what's on my iPod and my, you know, my devices, it's like it can be anything from progressive rock to, you know, popular music or jazz, or depending on what mood I'm in. You know, sometimes when I'm just like hanging out at home with the boys, you know, we'll have some, I don't know, hip hop music playing or some R&B music if I'm going to go out or whatever. It's just so varied. And what I like most about that is that it's the same approach I take into my job. Like, you can see from, you know, my CV that it's not one particular thing that I've done or that I do. There's so many different, you know, variants into the styles I play and the people, the art, the types of art I've worked with. And I remember as a kid growing up, actually, being a big fan of, you mentioned him earlier, Omar Akeem, and I remember, you know, seeing him play with Weather Report and then playing with Madonna.
Yeah.
And then, you know, playing with Sting. I'm like, wow, I want to be that guy who can play, you know, there's not one particular style that he's just pinned to. He can bring a different vibe and an energy to all sorts. And it was something that I was thinking about at a very young age. So, again, you know, when I've had the opportunity to meet people, you know, have the opportunity to meet Omar, and one of the things he said was, you just got to be varied with your listening. You know, you don't have to sit there for hours. You know, it's like if you're in the car and, you know, you're listening to radio, you know, one day you might put on a bit of classical, or one day you'll have a rock station on, or, you know, it's just be open to various types of music, and it'll just open you up musically as you're, you know, you're sort of listening to these things indirectly or subconsciously. You know, it all has an effect on your particular style going forward, you know? So that's kind of my stance on it, really.
No, that makes sense. Again, great political answer. This has been a message for Donovan Hepburn for mayor. there we go, man. I got you. I'm going to be your campaign manager when you run, brother, because I know you can win, whatever.
I think it'll be a brilliant team. Like a great team.
I got the media support you, man. You know, the biased media. There we go.
There you go.
So, brilliant. You know, kind of going back to that point, though, you bring up a good point. Right now, you know, I've done a lot of work with the millennials. I'm definitely not a millennial. I'm far from it. I'm almost not quite a baby boomer, but I'm right. You know, one more year, I would have been a baby boomer if I was born a year earlier.
Right.
But with that said, you know, it seems that the millennial way is kind of it's because there's so much available. It actually is. It limits them because they just go with what's, you know, within their circle of influence, because there's so much of that there, you know. And you mentioned being varied on your flavors, listening to everything and anything is possible. You know, so that, I think that's a good start. But we've got about 3.5 minutes left here. What would be your, recommendations, your tips, you know, what would you say for the coming up generation of musicians, to kind of incorporate into their lives, into their pursuit of their artistic craft?
I think what I would say is that you've got to go back to source. That's what I think, and a lot of music today has been influenced by so much music from the 60s, 50s, you know, earlier. You kind of got to go back to source. So, again, you know, you sort of, you think of bands like the Beatles or Queen, and you have to put Jeff and the ELO in there. It's like, you know, these guys have had so much influence on popular music today. So my advice would be just to go to source. You know, if obviously depending on what you're into right now, try and find out what they were influenced by, you know, and sort of do some research. And, you know, bands like Genesis, and the list is endless, really.
Yeah, back to Genesis, you know, when Peter Gabriel was the singer, right?
Exactly. Yes. You know, there's so much. You've got to sort of go back to source, really, and seek those type of bands out. And then it sort of, as you start to move back forward, it kind of all makes sense, you know?
Yeah, definitely.
That's what has worked for me, you know?
I hear you 100%, man. And then with 2 minutes left, this is the 2 minute warning here for those sports fans. What new group inspires you right now? What is that group that you're like, man, these guys get it. They're young, but they're fresh. They're new. They're going to be going somewhere.
Okay. There's a band out of the UK called 1975.
Okay.
The 1975, and they're sort of, they're kind of early 20s. And when I listen to them, it's like being catapulted back into the 60s, you know, just like the way their songs are put together, the way they're executing them. They're all sort of, they kind of produce the music themselves, they record it themselves, and they play it. And it's just like, they're great. I've just, you know, I was introduced to them about 3 or 4 years ago. So I've kind of, you know, become a little bit of a fan. They're one of the sort of modern sort of group that I'm into. Yeah.
Definitely. Awesome.
And you can hear the influence that they've, you know, that all the stuff they've been listening to through their music.
Perfect, brother. Well, hey, man, we are down to the last 30 seconds. I want to say thank you very much, Donovan, for taking the time while you're on tour to make this happen, brother. We appreciate you. We'll be supporting you. Once you've been inducted into our alumni association, you cannot get back out. You're part of this now. You're part of the InterTalk Media family. You know, we appreciate you, man. So I thank you very much. Thank you, Yamaha, for the spotlight. Stay on. Well, I wanted to kind of talk to you a little bit after this. Just stay on for a few minutes.
Okay.
Of course, Jambox and Pitbull Audio. I want to say thanks to you guys and SIR at sir-usa.com. Thanks for keeping the tours alive. This has been another Changing Stage radio show. My name is Florentino Bonaventura with Donovan Hepburn, Yamaha Spotlight artist. And stay tuned for the next show. Thanks.
You know what's all around you every waking moment of your life? Marketing. You're choking on it. I'm Scott Robertson, and when it comes to strategic PR, branding, and marketing, I've seen it all. And actually, I'm still seeing it because bad marketing never sleeps. Join me each week on May the Best Brand Win, right here on InterTalk Radio, and learn how to make the marketing for your brand unforgettable.
Hi, this is Tim Dolbear from Eclectica Studios. I'm a full-time mixing and recording engineer. I work with Grammy winners, labels, and indie artists. Using state-of-the-art digital mixing and restoration tools and the very best in analog gear. Really, though, it's my ability to bring tracks to life and fulfill your vision for your music. This has made me sought after by producers and artists worldwide. So spend your time working on music and not chasing a mix down a rabbit hole. Go to timdolbear.com and check out our free one-song mix offer.
Are you serious about your music? Are you ready to run with the big dogs? The experts at Pitbull Audio have the gear to get you into the game. From leading manufacturers like Mesa Boogie, Fender, Pioneer, and American Audio, to sound your best, you need the best. Pitbull Audio can deliver in rehearsal, on stage, and into the big time. Dropping beats, shredding guitar, or making the crowd roar. Whatever you dream, Pitbull Audio can help make it happen. We are Pitbull Audio. We want you to play it loud. PitbullAudio.com.
This is Jackie Bertone from Jackie's Groove. Come join me weekly on my journey through the music business as I take you behind the velvet rope, interviewing industry notables such as Al Di Meola, Michael McDonald, and Al Jarreau, to name but a few. Listen to their stories on being in the studios recording number one hits and onto the stages throughout the globe. Allow me to be your music historian. You can hear me live every Monday at 2 p.m. and every Wednesday at 12 noon Pacific Standard Time or 24/7 on jackiesgroove.com. Ready to get your groove on?